Nephilometry, another meningismus question. So where do you use it? Okay, how many of you want to do immunology? See, if you take up rarer specialities, you become successful in life much faster. So rarer specialities means one of my distant cousin, after finishing MBBS, he says that I don't want to do MD. Who wants to do MD? MBA, software development, they're all better specialties than that of medicine. I was telling that very rare opportunity to become opportunity to treat people. He says, tell all that behind the church, not to me, because no more all those sweet words of the glamorous career being a MD and all that. I see a lot of MDs who are unsuccessful and working just like a secretariat government officials. All my other friends want to do other things. So I was telling him that it's not really that. I am unable to impress upon him, honestly speaking. So that's the reason, Dr. Why we came to the topic. Immunology is one division. Lot of immunological disorders. There are no specialists at all. Rheumatology is a rarer specialty. Though you may be bored that every day I see only rheumatoid arthritis, SLE, and only 4 to 5 conditions. But that is what makes it a better thing than others. So that's the reason, Dr. Nephilometry is immunology laboratory use it in order to determine the level of IgM, IgG, and IgA is what has to be remembered. You will be shining a light and how much it is scattering out and reflecting, you will measure. Suppose if it is a immunoglobulin G, a bigger molecule than the IgA, let us say, it will scatter a different amount of light. So throw the light and catch it back, and depending upon the how much is scattering happening, you guess what is the molecular weight of that particular and size of that substance tested, and based on that you will know is it IgA, IgM or IgG. There's a reason, doctor, what is your answer? It is the scattering of the light from the particles is the underlying physics principle in the nephilometry is what need to be remembered. Thiopentone, once more our traditional question has come. You should not do wrong in such questions. Suppose our preparation is good, we'll be waiting for traditionals. 160 traditionals without mistake and without shaking, you are able to answer. This will become your last entrance to face. Of course, DM is, will also be waiting after MD. Then thiopentone reduces the cerebral blood flow and intracranial pressure basically, and that's the reason that is one important thing. Now, do you like to use thiopentone in shock? No, because thiopentone can induce hypotension, which is unacceptable, especially in elderly people. Autonomic neuropathy is there in them. Hypotension is cannot be compensated because of their autonomic neuropathy. So don't use thiopentone, which carries this adverse effect of hypotension is what need to be basically remembered. That's the reason it is contraindicated in porphyria, true, and but it is not an induction agent of choice in shock is what need to be remembered. And let's go to the next question. 18-year-old presenting with galactorrhea, amenorrhea, weight loss. So how do you manage it? Galactorrhea and amenorrhea, they are the common topic for endocrinologists, physician, gynecologists and obstetrician. So let us be sure about. The most common pathological cause leading to the development of galactorrhea on any given day is pituitary tumor. After infancy, it can also be because of medication induced. There's a reason, only simple thing. If a patient presents with galactorrhea, you have to check for the drug history. And also you should ask, do you have any headache? Do you have amenorrhea? Do you have diplopia? Do you have any blurring of vision? And based on that, you should go for a CT brain in order to find out the presence of the pituitary adenoma. Even primary hypothyroidism can cause the galactorrhea in the case of the children and adults, but not the in this, the other symptoms cannot be explained by your hypothyroidism hypothesis here. There's a reason, doctor, quickly based on the history, how do you pin down your diagnosis? Neonatal period, it can be a physiological neonatal galactorrhea which can be there. If headache, visual disturbances, seizures and disordered appetite is there, pituitary or hypothalamic lesion, decreased libido, infertility, oligomenorrhea, impotence is there, think of hyperprolactinemia, and if there is any tiredness, cold intolerance, constipation plus galactorrhea, then think of hypothyroidism, and if at all there is any medication history, that is what need to be clearly be taken. There's a reason by that logic. Pituitary adenoma stands as the highest chance underlying malignancy, which is responsible. Now let us talk about the vitiligo, another traditional topic in dermatology. We should not do mistake. Leukotrichia, what do you mean by leukotrichia, doctor? It is a depigmentation of the body hair is called as the leukotrichia. And the leukotrichia, if at all, it is coexistent in the case of the vitiligo. Vitiligo is only skin. If even hair is showing the depigmentation, that carries a poor prognosis is what need to be basically remembered. So there is a depigmentation of the epidermis, and it is basically an acquired progressive disorder, vitiligo, where the melanocytes are the ones in the interfollicular epidermis which are at a fault, is what has to be understood. But is there any genetic predisposition for development of vitiligo? Very much. There is autosomal dominant kind of inheritance which is identified, HLA-DR4, HLA-B13, HLA-B35, everything is being identified. Now how do you manage? Another option given to you, the vitiligo. PUVA, the ultraviolet A, is the one which can be used along with the methoxysorolin. No hurry, UVB was given among the options, right? But even UVB also has got a great role. The narrow band UVB phototherapy also is the one which has got a wonderful results. Even excimer laser, which is used in high myopias, etc., even used in dermatology, along with is the one which can be used in the stable patches of the vitiligo. Systemic steroids can be used, topical steroids can be used, but steroids really long term you can't live with the steroid. That's the reason you need to try with the UVB, etc., etc., much more efficiently. And topical tacrolimus ointment can be used, and calcipotriene and UVB can also be combined and tried. So dermatology is such a challenge, especially with vitiligo-like scenario. That's the reason, what is your correct answer, doctor, here? PUVA B is used, topical steroids are used, and leukotrichia has a bad prognosis, not a good prognosis, is what need to be remembered. Let us talk about the Down syndrome, another traditional question. Typically, the first trimester markers of the Downs include PAP-A, which is pregnancy-associated plasma protein A, the beta-HCG and nuchal translucency. Alpha-fetoprotein, unconjugated estriol, they all come under the second trimester markers, and even the beta-HCG and inhibin A, they all can be used. Now let us talk, how do they behave? Typically, PAP-A on average will be lower, not higher. That's the reason that becomes the answer in Down syndrome. Whereas nuchal translucency, free beta HCG, they are the ones which are on the higher side, is what has to be remembered. And in the second trimester, alpha-fetoprotein and the E3 levels are lower. So that is how you basically conclude. And inhibin levels become once more higher in Down syndrome. So you must be sure which are higher, which are lower, in the case of the Down's antenatal screening. So this is a 12-week-old, you can see what is the meaning of a nuchal translucency. Typically this is the neck area, this is the fetal head. So in this area you can see the presence of the translucency, highly indicative. Similarly, Doppler can help you to identify certain chromosomal abnormalities based upon the flow pattern. But where do you examine for the flow pattern using the Doppler in the antenatal screening? Typically, umbilical artery, umbilical vein, descending aorta, uterine artery and middle cerebral artery, they are the areas where Doppler is being used. Generally, the umbilical artery will show a high amount of impedance to the flow, and there is no end-diastolic flow which is absent. But in the case of the Down syndrome, typically, the reversal of the diastolic venous flow, what is the reason for that? It is because the turbulence of the blood which is being created is a very important radiological marker of the presence of the Downs, is what you need to basically remember. Similarly, what is the congenital heart disease and Downs you have to remember, doctor? Typically, atrioventricular septal defects, endocardial cushion defects, they are very common in Downs. And the nasal bone can become typically absent in the case of the Down syndrome, another important radiological feature. And in the fingers, can you identify anything antenatally? It is the camptodactyly of the fifth finger is the one which is typically identified in the Down syndrome in the antenatal period, is what has to be remembered. Pulmonary thromboembolism, traditional question. As a house surgeon, you must have managed a good number of dyspneic patients. DVT was documented, bedridden state because there was an orthopedic fracture, suddenly presenting with shortness of breath, and there was a respiratory failure, and thrombolysis is considered the best option available at that point if you diagnose the pulmonary thromboembolism. D-dimers. D-dimers are good as a MCQ in entrance. Not as a postgraduate first year MD, you talk about D-dimer, you are being banned of the wards. Because it is very non-specific marker, like ESR. You are angry, your ESR can go up. You are happy, it can come down. So non-specific is D-dimer. But you talk about what in first year MD, doctor? CT angio is a wonderful investigation which can identify, delineate wherever embolus is there, is it wedge-shaped, and is there any oligemia of that vessels which are blocked. All this can be identified by taking the CT. But I like to ask you a question. What is the role of ventilation perfusion scan? Ideally speaking, a patient who is so dyspneic with pulmonary embolism, do you think practically you can put him to the radionuclide lab and then inject and then take a wonderful perfusion scan? Very difficult. What is the ventilation scan we use clinically generally? We don't do any ventilation scan. We take the chest X-ray. And then we take the perfusion scan. We see, is there any good ventilation but a bad perfusion by matching the chest X-ray as a ventilation scan and the perfusion scan in the radionuclear lab. So comparing the two, but that is not all for the acute pulmonary thromboembolism. Patient can simply cannot lie down with so much of pulmonary hypertension RVF in the radionuclide lab. But CT angio can very much help in that scenario. So if you take the sensitivity of the CT angio to pick up the pulmonary embolism, it is around 100% from 53%. Negative predicted value is 81 to 100%. What do you expect in CT? There will be intravascular filling defect of that pulmonary vessel which is being blocked. There can be a vascular occlusion, pulmonary hemorrhage, pulmonary infarction, etc., etc. Now you can see how a high probability perfusion lung scan where the perfusion deficits are being identified. Now you can see this is the perfusion deficit, but the corresponding ventilation is not showing any deficit. That is called the mismatch on the ventilation perfusion scan. And there is the posterior wedge-shaped infarct which you are able to see here just above the diaphragm. You are able to see in the last row, doctor. This is the wedge-shaped infarct which is called the Hampton's hum. If you do the CT angio, you can see that there is no vascularity coming out and there is a filling defect which is being identified in the pulmonary vessel. Is a classical example of CT angio's role. And if you do a pulmonary angiogram, in fact, then you can see that this side vessels are not filling, this side vessels are filling because there is the major pulmonary artery got blocked. That's the reason, doctor, helical CT angiography is considered to be now the gold standard in identifying and delineating the anatomy of the pulmonary thromboembolism. 70-year-old hypertensive, episode of syncope on ECG. I don't know what ECG strip was given, but you don't need to see ECG also. Like USMLE clinical vignettes. You think you can, in USMLE, you can read all the question, everything, and analyze even those X-rays, etc. Difficult. History itself is like a thumb, doctor. Listening on telephone, you must tell what is a possible diagnosis, mostly. So that's the reason, doctor, at least in this scenario, I think that probably it could be a complete heart block ECG. Anybody can... All? Tall R wave is there. It could be, generally tall R wave can be a reflective change of a posterior wall infarct, depending on which lead, in anterior leads. A posterior wall infarct will present with a tall R wave. And what was inverted T waves were also there. But in this, probably another possibility is if there is any pulmonary thromboembolism, if there is a right ventricular strain because of that and a right ventricular failure, that can also present. But the remaining part of the clinical history is not so classical for the pulmonary embolism here. Right sided? Clinical features were given, right side failure. It was a V1 strip. Okay. Then that is much more suggestive. But anyway, this question I leave it for the imagination. Then thromboprophylaxis, heparin, warfarin, aspirin, but not antithrombin 3. What is the role of antithrombin, doctor? It is a serine protease inhibitor. if the factor 8 need to become active factor 8 and really show its ability to clot the blood, it requires initial activation with the help of certain proteases. The antithrombin basically will inhibit those proteases, so there is nobody to activate the factor 7, so they remain inactive, and there is a reason they can't clot and there is a bleeding diathesis. Suppose if antithrombin deficiency is there, what will happen? There is nobody to stop protease. Protease will convert factor 7 to active factor, so more amount of activation is there, hence there is a prothrombotic state. So antithrombin deficiency leads to prothrombosis and excess of it lead to bleeding, but that is not the one which is used conventionally in the thromboprophylaxis. Patient has got a retrocecal appendicitis, then which maneuver can be able to produce the pain? So here we need to remember that what are the common signs of appendicitis? You have got psoas sign, where the pain on extension of the right thigh typically can cause the retroperitoneal retrocecal appendix to cause the pain. Similarly, obturator sign, pain on internal rotation of the right thigh can cause the pelvic appendix, which is inflamed, to cause the pain. Rossing's is a pain in the right lower quadrant with palpation of the left lower quadrant. And Dumphy's sign is increased pain with coughing in appendicitis, all of you know very well. So this is a typical psoas sign where you are trying to cause a passive extension of the right thigh with the patient lying on the left side, and the retrocecal appendix can typically lead to the development of pain because psoas and retrocecal appendix are in a very close anatomical relationship. Similarly, a passive internal rotation of a flexed thigh also leads to development of pain in the obturator sign, which is seen in the case of the pelvic appendicitis, is what need to be basically remembered. Cryoprecipitate, traditional question, what does it contain? Typically 80 to 100 international units of factor 8 and 1 Willebrand factor, 150 to 300 grams of fibrinogen and 40 to 60 units of factor 8. That constitutes one single unit of cryoprecipitate. Where can you use it, doctor? If I have efibrinogenemia, dysfibrinogenemia, such a patient you can use cryoprecipitate. Similarly, if I have hemophilia A with factor 8 deficiency, cryoprecipitate can also be used. So they are the important indications. In asphyxial death, which is the one which is last to be opened during the dissection, I tried to search for the answer for this, I could not get it. What is first and last? At least hypoxic death leads to the fluidity of the blood. It also causes some changes in the brain. But what is first and what is last? I like to get a reference from my students. Now, what is normally seen in the lying down position? This is very important point I like to precipitate, doctor, at least for those much younger junior house surgeons who are aspiring for the next June 2008. Exercise physiology and the physiology of the postural changes in hemodynamics had been from times immemorial a favorite topic for the examiner in AIMS. You must be very sure what happens to our blood with the postural changes. Cardiac output will increase when we are in a lying down position, and also the venous return preload will increase. End-diastolic volume, naturally preload will constitute the end-diastolic volume, and the stroke volume, all of them will typically become increased. Heart rate typically will decrease whenever we are in lying down position than in a standing position, is what has to be appreciated. Hence, increase in heart rate is the one which is not seen, but increase in venous return is very much seen. Just you can make a note of what are the other options given, that would help us a lot. And quickly to review, doctor, cardiac output typically horizontally when we are lying down it will increase, heart rate will increase in the standing position, stroke volume will increase in horizontal, and AVO2 difference and the systemic vascular resistance and systolic blood pressure and the mean arterial pressure, all of them typically will increase whenever we are in the standing position. Of course, the systolic blood pressure doesn't vary much between standing and the horizontal position. Now, exercise physiology is a very important topic. What happens in exercise? All the blood will flow to our muscles rather than to the brain preferentially during the exercise. So this increase typically occurs within about how much period of time? That is what I could not get a reference. It increases, we know, but is it in half minute, 1 minute, few seconds? but definitely not in few hours. It is in few minutes only, but most of the references say around, it takes around 2 to 5 minutes, but not this half minute, I could not get it. And there's a generalized vasodilatation. Why does it happen? Because the accumulation of all those vasodilator substances is what need to be remembered. But important thing is, the body temperature will increase when we are basically exercising is what need to be remembered. And the breathing capacity also will increase, and our pulmonary ventilation increases by about 50% at the time of exercise is what has to be remembered. What is the most common type of seizure in infants? In neonates, sorry. Very simple question to sound, right? But we are struggling between, is it tonic or subtle seizures? How many would vote for tonic? Subtle? Oh, very good. So I am in the midst of August gathering. Of course, you're all academic stalwarts because you're all distinction holders, and that's the reason I was telling that our students succeed not because of only the impact of coming down. It is your colleagues, your own other gladiators that actually bring that pleasure in preparation. That is what we have to basically have. So most neonatal seizures are focal, not generalized. That's the most important dictum. Subtle seizures are the ones which are the most common in the full term. In fact, more than, if you compare full term and premature, subtle become much more commoner. And most of the subtle seizures, why they are called subtle? Because they do not cause any EEG changes. But if you take those which cause EEG changes, then clonic seizures are the most common. But anyway, examiner did not give EEG changes or not. For the other types, doctor, you can also find tonic, generalized tonic, clonic, and myoclonic, etc., etc. But overall, if you take 50% would be subtle, 5% are tonic, 25 to 30% will be clonic, and 15 to 20% are myoclonic. So subtle constitute the most common type of seizure in the case of the neonatal population. Now this is an interesting question. Second part of the axillary artery got blocked. Then how the collaterals develop from where to where? So do you think we need to talk about from the first part to third part collaterals, or between the axillary and the subclavian collaterals? What exactly should be the answer? Yes? Collaterals between? First to third we need to talk. Okay. At least let us quickly review. What are the various branches of the different parts of the axillary artery? One of the favorite questions in anatomy. She tastes like a sweet apple pie. She is the superior thoracic artery, the branch of the first part. Thoracoacromial and lateral thoracic from the second part, and subscapular, anterior circumflex humeral and posterior circumflex humeral are the part of the third part of the axillary artery. Now if the second part is blocked, one division of the third part cannot anyway provide collateral to the other division of the third part, because all the three divisions of the third part are not getting blood anyway. So if you look at the various arteries given here, you basically find four arteries here. You have a subscapular artery, posterior circumflex humeral artery, anterior circumflex humeral artery, and circumflex scapular artery. So anyway, it is ruled out that anterior and posterior circumflex humeral cannot form an anastomosis because both of them are originating from third part of the axillary artery. And let us look into what is this circumflex scapular and the subscapular. Basically, the subscapular artery is the largest branch of the axillary artery, and subscapular also is a branch of the third part. So there is a reason, doctor, even subscapular, and which is a branch of third part, and posterior circumflex humeral, which is also a part of third part, I don't find a logic that they can form a collateral. So the what is the only option that is available then? Then you have the circumflex scapular artery. But circumflex scapular artery is actually a branch of subscapular. So which is originating once more from the second part of the axillary artery. So now finally in conclusion, what we can be at least contemplate is, there is a system called scapular anastomosis. In the scapular anastomosis, you have transverse cervical, transverse scapular, branch of the subscapular, and the branches of the thoracic aorta. So there is a reason the branch of the subscapular artery can definitely constitute one of the components of the anastomotic channel because it's a part of the scapular anastomosis, and the posterior circumflex, one of the branches of the third part of the axillary, is at least to the level of our ignorance. So if you find a better answer for this, I like to listen from you. Now let's go to the next question. Postductal compression of aorta, once more, examiner must be a vascular surgeon. So how do the collaterals develop? Typically in a postductal coarctation of the aorta or a blockade of the aorta, after the origin of the ductus arteriosus or ligamentum arteriosum, collateral circulation develops between the proximal and the distal parts of the occlusion naturally, because of the contribution of four major vessels which contribute for those collaterals. What are those vessels? Subclavian artery, scapular artery, internal thoracic artery, intercostal arteries. They constitute that collateral circulation if there is any blockade of the aorta. Now, this collateral circulation is actually divided into an anterior collateral and a posterior collateral system. Now, let us examine that. Whenever there is a blockade of the aorta, the internal mammary artery and the epigastric arteries, they typically constitute a collateral system, which is called the anterior collateral system at the time of the blockade of the aorta. Whereas the parascapular arteries and the intercostal arteries, they both form basically the collaterals, which is basically called the posterior system. So that is the reason, doctor, in this given scenario, if there is a postductal compression of the aorta, then we need to identify internal mammary artery is the one which forms collaterals with the epigastric. So internal mammary was probably the option D, because epigastric basically forms collaterals with the internal mammary. That should be the one that should be there in this given scenario, which is not visible over here. Okay, let's go to the next question. The patient has got a non-blanching rash. What is the difference between a blanching and non-blanching rash? Is the rash is, which is a petechial rash is found, is it due to the thrombocytopenia or vasculitis? How can we know? Palpable purpurea are all vasculitic, and non-palpable are basically the thrombocytopenia petechiae association. Now the question is, vasculitic rash is palpable. Palpable means blanching or non-blanching? Non-blanching. Right? So there's a reason, there is a non-blanching rash which is there, proteinuria is there, arthritis is there, and hematuria is there. What else is required? There is a striptease of the whole topic. Henoch-Conlein's purpura, there is an immunoglobulin A, which is the one which is getting deposited, and there is a prominent cutaneous involvement. What is the classical tetrad of the Henoch-Conlein purpura, doctor? There is the presence of a rash which is typically purpuric, non-blanchable. It is found in 100% of cases of Henoch-Conlein's purpura. You also find arthralgias, which constitute 82%. And that vasculitis will involve the mesenteric vasculature, leading to ischemia of the bowel, leading to the development of abdominal pain, which constitutes the third feature. And also it involves the kidney, renal disease, 40%. So classic tetrad of the Henoch-Conlein purpura, which is the other spectrum of the IgA nephropathy, is what has to be remembered. But if there is a Henoch-Conlein purpura to your patient who is a small pediatric patient, what is the immediate botheration in your mind? Is he going to progress into chronic renal failure? You have to answer that to the parents. Urea is high, creatinine is high, hematuria is there. Doctor, is my child is going to go into the chronic renal failure. Only 1% chance is there, very low, for them to progress with the renal involvement in HSP into the chronic renal failure, is what has to be remembered. So quickly summarizing, the cutaneous purpura non-blanchable, the urinary sediment which shows the red blood cell cast, and the acute glomerular inflammation with the crescent formation, a rapidly progressive glomerulonephritis, and the mesangial proliferation with the IgA deposits. This constitutes what is called the diagnosis called Henoch-Conlein's purpura. Collapsing glomerulopathy. Many times we discuss the concept. Glomerulonephritis, chronic, is the favorite topic of examiner. We have to know membranous, membranoproliferative, FSGS. what are the underlying causes in HIV drug abusers, what type of glomerulonephritis is found, where do you find thickening of the GBM, where you don't find, all these are the favorite areas of examiner. That is the topic you have to be sure about. Can you give me the answer, doctor? Collapsing glomerulopathy is a variant of which type of glomerulonephritis? Membranous or membranoproliferative of type 1 or type 2 or FSGS? It is one of the variant of the FSGS. Basically, FSGS can be divided into primary and secondary. After that division is over, histologically they are of three types. Glomerular tip lesion, collapsing glomerulopathy, third is called the focal segmental glomerular scarring. There are the three different varieties of FSGS is what has to be remembered. So typically, the perihilar predominance of the sclerosis, what is FSGS? It is focal, involving only certain tubules and certain part of the whole amount of nephron. And it shows a characteristic sclerotic changes, scarring will be there, which is not found in other variants. That is another important feature of FSGS. That's the reason, where do you get FSGS, doctor? If there is any recurrent pyelonephritis, if there is HIV drug abuse, intense vasospasm with ischemia with scarring, HIV nephropathy, they are all the classical examples where FSGS is the type of glomerulopathy that you come across. So there can be a perihilar prominence of the sclerosis, there can be involvement of the tip, and there can be a collapsing of the capillaries which is being found, called the collapsing glomerulopathy. Now what are the three histological hallmarks of the collapsing glomerulopathy variant of FSGS? Number one, the glomerulus will collapse naturally. Visceral epithelial cells will undergo a damage and they undergo a rapid proliferation. And tubular interstitial, even tubule, not only glomerulus, tubule also will show the changes. And typically they present with nephrotic syndrome. Now tell me, what is the normal proteinuria in the blood, doctor, between 50 to 150, 24 hour urine if you calculate, that many number of grams, it is normal. If it is more than 1 gram, instead of 50 to 150 mg, 1 gram, then you start worrying about proteinuria. The moment it is around 3 to 4 grams of protein is lost every day, then that is almost a bankruptcy of the kidney. There is a nephrotic syndrome. But most of the nephrotic syndromes, like minimal change disease or membranous nephropathy, they never cause the proteinuria more than 5 or 6. So any patient who has got a nephrotic syndrome, who has a proteinuria, but which is more than 10 grams of protein he is losing in 24 hours every day, he deserves a renal biopsy, because one of the causes for such a massive proteinuria with a poor prognosis could be FSGS, is what you have to fundamentally understand. So there is a collapse of the glomerulus, podocytes undergo hypertrophy and hyperplasia, they are the important changes. So you can see the glomerular tuft has undergone the collapse with the hypertrophy of the podocytes over here. And there is a lot of visceral epithelial cell proliferation. Now I want to ask you a question. All of you know crescentic glomerulonephritis, which leads to RPGN, rapidly progressive glomerulonephritis also called. What are these crescents, doctor? It is the parietal epithelial cells which are undergoing a rapid proliferation lead to the crescent formation in the crescentic glomerulonephritis. But in the case of collapsing glomerulopathy, the proliferation is there, not in the parietal. Where do you find them? Visceral epithelial cells is what you have to basically remember. So the collapse of the matrix, and very important feature is even tubule, not only glomerulus, shows the changes. Where there is a hypertrophy of the tubular cells, so there is a reason, doctor, there is a microcystic dilatation of the tubules, which is another important feature of the collapsing glomerulopathy. Now let us quickly revise, doctor. Do you find proliferation of parietal cells in collapsing glomerulopathy? No. What you find is visceral epithelial cells which are proliferating. And there is a mesangial proliferation which is there, which is causing the collapse of the glomerulus, not a mesangiolysis. And the tubular epithelial cells definitely undergo the hypertrophy and necrosis, which is the classical feature, where though it is glomerulopathy, still there is a tubular change in this important variant. I think this is above the median frequency kind of question. But you can't help also because you have a MD general medicine as your teacher. Because these are the things which are a routine part in renal pathology. You have to talk about all these things and you have a lot of nephrotic syndrome patients around you. Now peristalsis of ureter, heart has a pacemaker, mind has a pacemaker, does the pacemaker is there for ureter? There. But it is not the one which decides the peristaltic movement. Peristaltic movement is still under the autonomic control of the sympathetic plexuses which are located within the wall of the ureter is what need to be remembered. Is it good or bad? Otherwise you would have had, you have to purchase one pacemaker for heart, another for the ureter and live with multiple pacemakers, right? Luckily it is not the scenario. Sympathetic ganglia are the ones which are the deciding factor. In mitral valve prolapse, it is the myxomatous degeneration as all of you know very well. Rheumatic carditis with the mitral regurgitation, why should it cause lung changes? Is there any, is the question correct first of all? Yes. Please be little. Excellent. That is what we were also thinking, like maybe MR leads to development of pulmonary edema, examiner is asking what lung changes will be there. Now let us talk about it. A pulmonary edema typically will decrease the residual volume first and then the vital capacity. There is a reason, increase in residual volume is what you don't find. Then similarly, the total lung capacity also become decreased in the case of the pulmonary edema which is induced by the mitral regurgitation and rheumatic carditis is what I like to underscore. But why do you do spirometry in a cardiothoracic surgery preoperative assessment of the patient before posting him for surgery? Suppose he has got MR, definitely. So in spirometry you want to know whether he, does he require ventilator, what kind of prognosis is there, etc., etc. Especially with unstable heart, with the chance of flash pulmonary edema happening with a valvular heart disease like MR, you must be very sure to do both cardiac and pulmonary assessment of the patient preoperatively. Now fracture of the fifth metatarsal following a forceful inversion is because of the force caused by whom? Typically in the fractures of the fifth metatarsal, fifth is big toe or small toe? Small toe, right? So typically doctor you have got two important varieties. Tuberosity of the fifth metatarsal can undergo an avulsion fracture because the tendinous pull of the peroneus brevis. Second type is there can be a trauma of the proximal metatarsal which is called the Jones fracture. Actually Jones was dancing in the ballroom after taking a full bottle of wine and he had a fracture. Then he discovered that and then that's how the Jones has come into vogue. So if you take the peroneus brevis tendon doctor, this is the peroneus brevis you can see and you can see fourth and fifth metatarsal. So this is the area where tuberosity's avulsion can occur because this peroneus brevis tendon pull. And this is the area where basically you can find the Jones fracture. There are two different areas is what has to be appreciated. So the same movement which leads to ankle sprain, what is that movement? Inversion with a dorsiflexed foot is the same reason peroneus brevis also leads to the development of this fracture of the avulsion fracture of the fifth metatarsal is what need to be basically appreciated. Now you can be able to see here doctor, this is the area where the peroneus brevis is having an attachment and it caused the avulsion and you can see the fracture line over here is a typical fracture is what I like to underscore. And a little ahead of the tubercle you can see the area where the Jones fracture is found up, which is within 1.5 centimeters from the point of tuberosity is what I like to underscore. At the time of emergency tracheostomy, are there any two things called emergency tracheostomy, elective tracheostomy, are they different? Definitely. What is the other name given for emergency tracheostomy? Cricothyrotomy. So that's the reason doctor, in case of emergency laryngotomy or tracheostomy, cricothyroidotomy, what we will be doing is you will be far away from that of the thyroid isthmus. You don't injure it. You will be far away from it and you will be making an insertion surgically or through a needle into the cricothyroid membrane is what need to be remembered. Whereas in the case of the elective tracheostomy, it is the second and third tracheal rings, the point where you will be doing the cutting and this is the point where you will be dividing the thyroid isthmus. So you don't touch thyroid isthmus in cricothyroidotomy, whereas you touch that in the case of elective tracheostomy is what has to be basically understood. Now, in the left lung hilum, what is the uppermost structure? All of you know very well, there's a pulmonary artery, pulmonary vein, and the bronchial vessels. Pulmonary artery, the superior most structure, and then you have the superior and inferior pulmonary veins, and then you have the bronchus and the bronchial vessels. That's how they are basically aligned.